My brother.
Understanding is that after the conversation, you will move forward. Please.
As we all are eminent Nigerians, we are ready to bring to the high table.
I am fine.
We have two chief lunches. The chief luncher, Dr. Paul Akintelure. Please. Okay. I'll tell you. You can do things gratis and all of us have to channel the gratis.
I'm very, very well informed Nigerians. There is a rather interesting meeting taking place after I leave here, and it's not taking place in Lagos, so I have to run to the meeting later this evening in Abuja. That's why I crave the indulgence of your speak. And of course, I have to do that. I know you did very, very well. If you do, you'd like to be in pieces, even though I haven't said it. But if college reputation is anything to go by, you would always be giving us a book at the end of the review. So if you wanted to interject before you do that, and maybe I can do the review for him. We will have a lot to say after. But let me really congratulate our brother, Mobolade Omonijo, and express my own deep gratitude for the privilege of addressing this very special gathering at the occasion of the public presentation of Mobolade's book, The Nigerian Political Turf, Polity, Politics, Politicians. When I first saw the title of the book, it reminded me so much of a similarly titled book by the late James Adibolaye, aka Uncle Bola, progressive politician, intellectual of Salon, and former Attorney General of Nigeria. That fascinating book entitled People, Politics, and Politicians of Nigeria, 1940 to 1979, published by Heinemann, chronicle of the world's reflections on the triumphs and travails. quality during the period before independence to the resumption of democratic rule in 1979. Written almost 20 years before Mobolade's book, on Mobolade's inimitable and often irreverent style, I presaged many of the issues raised in this new book. In a prescient manner, leaving anyone reading Mobolade's book with almost a sense of deja vu. While it is really not my task to review Mobolade's book, having been saddled with an altogether different task, that of reflecting on the quality, politics, and politicians from the perspective of an active participant, so-called. It will nevertheless be remiss of me not to comment on the timeliness and timelessness of the book at a time that many continue to worry about the Nigeria project. As a journalist of repute, experience, and exposure, Mr. Omonijo has done a brilliant job of placing the people, our citizens, at the center of this retrospective assessment of his last 25 years in journalism. He highlights important issues like democracy, constitutionalism, poverty, terrorism, development, as well as regional integration. In his own view, 50 years after independence, and a century after amalgamation, politics and politicking have still not served the people of Nigeria well. The country is far from being a nation, and the polity is in need of comprehensive restructuring. He underscores the importance of institutions much more than personalities, especially institutions that can mediate the relationship between the leaders and the led, relationship between tiers of government and the electoral process through which leaders are recruited. He paints the polity in the frightening image of the obscene state of nature, nasty, brutish, and about to be caught short. Many Nigerians groan that Nigeria is at another crossroads. For such people, the country only seems to go from crisis to crisis. If truth be told, there seems to be a vibrant industry of Niger pessimism right now. Like most Nigerians, the author, Mr. Omonijo, appears very cynical about the average Nigerian politician. He is, however, hopeful about the possibilities the country holds for the future, provided certain things are in place. The picture of the politician that emerges from this book is one of an unconscionable, venal, greedy, corrupt leech, feeding off society, and one who will seize any opportunity to fleece the people. Whether one agrees with this view of the Nigerian politician or not, very few in our country today disagree that the nation is experiencing a leadership challenge. Nigerians mistrust and distrust their leaders, be they politicians, captains of industry, faith-based clerics, media watchdogs, or civil society activists. I suppose, as an active participant who has been asked to reflect on the current challenges in the polity, my task is not to bemoan the fate of our troubled institutions in the polity. It is to profound, insofar as my experience can take me, what should be done about the critical problems highlighted in Mr. Omonijo's book, and outline how we must work expeditiously towards their resolution. A progressive participant observer, in my view, would want to call attention to what must be done to increase the population of those who access power, with a view to serving the people and launching the country on an irreversible path of development. He would want to reflect, for example, on what is the place of violence in politics. How can transactional politics be replaced with transformational leadership? How should institutions of state be strengthened to ensure effective checks and balances? What should be done to promote internal democracy in political parties? sharpened to the point that the bare bones are now visible. The failure to address the national question in an inclusive manner is evident in the varied responses across the country to conflict over identity, nationality, self-determination, and autonomy. These issues are in turn bound up with such other questions as what manner of federation do Nigerians want. Unlike in the past, when governments have always agreed issues like religion, autonomy, and resource control as constitutional no-go areas, Nigerians are now forcing these issues in the open, and the eventual authoritarian might of the federal center is now being put to test. What is this nation called Nigeria? What does it mean to be Nigerian? How do we manage diversity and difference in a multi-ethnic, multi-faith polity? These are some of the questions that we avoided in the events leading up to May 29, 1999, in our desperation for anything but the military. As a participant observer, equally troubled and concerned by this untoward development in the polity, I have attempted to reflect on these questions as they affect us. Of course, as someone who was on the outside looking in, and now, according to Mobolade, an active participant on the inside by taking self-introspection, I know how tempting it is for those on the outside, particularly my friends in the fourth estate, to assume a moral high ground. They are irrepressible in the belief that the politicians are the problems. I also know that politicians see themselves as reflections of their society, which often compel them to act in a Jekyll and Hyde dual mode. On the one hand, charismatic, visionary, caring, fascinating, and sophisticated, but also on the other hand, repulsive, cynical, calculating, corrupt, and opportunistic. My own interest is really not to indulge in any deep philosophical or academic ideas about the distinction between transactional politics and transformational leadership, many of which you are familiar with, but to simply explore the necessity for citizens' engagement in a democracy. I also want to underscore the importance of accountability to the citizens by those elected to serve them. It is my own conviction that when there is no active civil society engagement, there can be no responsible and responsive political society. And such a state runs the risk of decay and eventual illegitimacy. I intend to argue based on my own experience in politics, rather limited, that politics properly conducted is a form of social activism and another stage in the struggle to restore the dignity of humankind. It is an integrated continuum rather than discreetly compartmentalized oppositional phenomenon. It is often complicated and contradictory, but mostly, if well done in the quest to make a fundamental difference to society. This is perhaps why the issue today should not be one for politicians or non-politicians, but the extent to which we're able to achieve citizens' participation in our democracy. The issue of leadership, particularly how we conceptualize leadership, is central to the discourse. In my view, our discussion should really focus more on the making of leaders and citizens in a good society, because without direct citizen participation, the legitimacy of our political institutions will continue to decline. It is for this reason that I strongly believe that leaders, be they politicians or non-politicians, should worry because their ability to lead effectively is being seriously undermined by the desertion of the average citizen from the public space, deepening the crisis of legitimacy in the country. Yet, this lack of legitimacy cuts both ways. When we, the people, withdraw our trust in our leaders or discountenance politicians, We make our democratic institutions less effective and risk making ourselves ungovernable. For too long, our political culture has perpetuated the need that strong leaders are really what we need. Leaders that can bring about change single-handed, rather than combat the formal authority derived from legitimate electoral mandate into a process of democratic renewal. I do not believe in this. The myth of the heroic and charismatic leader often dominates the literature on leadership. In my own view, though, real leadership ought to involve motivating people to solve problems within their own communities, rather than reinforcing the overlordship of the state on citizens. It is to build as well as strengthen political institutions that can mediate between individual and group interests. Professor Joseph Nye, the Dean of Harvard's John Kennedy School of Government, who coined the term soft power, defined leaders as those who help a group create and achieve shared goals. The authoritarian residues of politics in Nigeria continue to see leaders as magicians with all the answers to societal problems. And the measurable disappointment when we fail to live up to these exaggerated expectations. The main challenge, therefore, in my view, is both a psychological and a contextual one, and it centers on de-emphasizing superficial and unearned notions of heroic leadership by reconnecting democratic choices with people's day-to-day experience and to extend democratic principles to everyday situations in citizens' communities and constituencies. This is the reason why leadership for me must be mediated by the context of power and political structure. What do I mean by this? Many of us in this room, and many are familiar with this story, will recall that at the commencement of the current political dispensation in 1999, many were of the view that the path we were treading was one of transition without transformation. We argued severally, I was one of them, that it was wrong to suggest that any opening after Nigeria's prolonged authoritarian rule was irreversible and would lead to the deepening of democracy without interrogating the nature of the opening itself. Many felt at the time that we needed to think more carefully about the implications of what we considered to be a guided and state-managed transition, because even if Ali Baba of the time was dead, many of the 40 kings were still very much around, especially in a setting where the authoritarian ethos, language, and character of command and control of public discourse remain very much in place. Looking back now, 13 years after, we may have been correct to be cautious about embracing the military transition of 1999. But I now believe we were tactically wrong for completely eschewing participation in politics at the time. The fact that the military had not responded to a full-scale defeat by the democracy and human rights movement could hardly be discounted in understanding the nature of post-military governance in our country. The eventual dominance of the party hierarchy by retired military generals and civilians closely connected to them certainly set the tone for party formation and also resulted in authoritarian presidential governance, particularly under President Obasanjo. Essentially, the outcome of that particular phase of the transition ensured a mere reconfiguration of the political space rather than guarantee a transformational leadership. Yet, even with all of this, we could have started the process of organizing along political lines, rather than agonizing about the militarized nature of power and leadership. After all, we, journalists and activists alike, were the ones who risked our lives to fight for the restoration of democracy in Nigeria, only to vacate the space when power was literally lying on the streets. So, we ended up with a democracy with pseudo-democrats. And yet we are worried about the low quality of our democracy and the deficits in our governance. For the majority of our citizens, democracy was supposed to bring the end of military dictatorship, both in form and in content. They hope that it will bring greater involvement of ordinary people in politics, whether in federal, state, and local institutions. They hope for real and immediate dividends in employment, in clean water, in affordable shelter, accessible healthcare, improved education, reliable and consistent power supply, rehabilitated roads, and of course, more food on the table. While we generally enjoy a qualitative air of freedom in the last decade, there is still despair, despondency, and disillusionment about the material dividends of this democracy. Democracy for the ordinary people is not an abstract concept. Indeed, they do not value democracy any less than their elite compatriots. But they want democracy to be relevant to their life in a concrete and fundamental manner. If democracy is not capable of wiping out poverty, curbing corruption, guaranteeing transparency, and improving the well-being and quality of life of our people, it is to them, at best, an empty concept, at worst, a sham. These are, however, not challenges charismatic politicians or heroic leaders are able to resolve on their own without a careful consideration of the context of the issues. It is for this reason that those who want to seriously redraw the map of Nigeria's future for the better must return to more solid ground rather than tie themselves to the apron strings of power holders. Power holders do neither have a track record nor demonstrate a vision that can inspire our people and offer them hope about tangible transformation. This solid ground, in my view, must be within a larger movement, one that accommodates the place of political institutions but are not dependent on them. It should not simply be the celebration of astute individuals or politicians as the ultimate panacea to our crisis of governance. The most practical way, in my view, to leave individual choice to collective responsibility is to participate in the institutions that influence our lives. We must ensure that formal and informal institutions are democratized and given more responsibilities for exercising state power. To do it well, we have to see Nigeria as a permanent enterprise that has to be fought over and restructured in order to provide power for all Nigerians. But politicians get abused all the time. The people are disillusioned about the state of affairs. Yet, if you make political discourse more negative as we do, you deliberately turn ordinary people off politics. More people grow cynical and stop paying any serious attention to politics.